I am the true vine, and I am the light of the world. Today, I would like for us to look at the statements about I am the light of the world, and look at, and see if we can reap something for our lives today out of this time in Scripture. We're going to be using three verses that are not tied together, so I'm going to read them out to you again in case you hadn't looked in your bulletin. It's John 8, verse 12, John 9, verse 5, and John 12, verse 46. So if you can read along with me in your Bibles, as we read God's Word. Then spake Jesus unto them, saying, I am the light of the world. He that followeth me shall not walk in darkness, but shall have the light of life. In chapter 9, verse 5, as long as I am in the world, I am the light of the world. And in John chapter 12, verse 46, I am come a light into the world, that whosoever believeth on me should not abide in darkness. His proclamation of I am the light, and then it follows that he says that that light makes a difference to you and I, that we should not walk in darkness, that he is that light. I was thinking that the very first thing that God did when we see in the Bible was that it says, in the beginning, God created the light. He created the light. In the beginning, God was there. And the Spirit of God moved upon the face of the deep. And God said, let there be light. And there was light. Think about that just a moment. It was 3 days, I believe, after that, or it was a few days after that, before he made the sun and the moon and the stars. He created light. The first thought that come into my mind that if we think of Jesus talking about that he is the light of the world, that at the very beginning, God revealed himself as light to a creation yet not made. But he makes the proclamation that light is here. And that's powerful because God is that light. If we think about how that the people of Jesus' day would have understood what he was saying, I think we need to look back at the Old Testament writings that they would have had. And in particular, I would like to look at how they would look at this illumination that God has in the prophet Isaiah's words in chapter 60 of his writings. Verse 19, it says this, and the sun shall be no more thy light by day, neither for brightness shall the moon give light unto thee, but the Lord shall be unto thee an everlasting light, and God thy glory. On into verse 20, thy sun shall no more go down, neither shall thy moon withdraw itself, for the Lord shall be thine everlasting light, and the days of thy mourning shall be ended. We see that the thought here that as they would think back at the prophet Isaiah, that God is saying through the prophet that God is light, and that light would be everlasting. It won't be something that will ever go out. We know that if we look into the New Testament all the way into Revelation, where there will be no need for the sun and moon there too, because Christ is the light that will be there. There will be day all the time. And we think about it. But as we look at those Isaiah verses, there's interesting that in verse 20, that he says that because of that light that is there, says thy days of mourning, and mourning is there, the grieving, it ain't like the dawning of a day, but mourning as in grieving shall be ended. Because God is there and we can trust him for those things and to be with us. Like we mentioned in the prayer request, that Jesus, when he went to about God being able to comfort the grieving, But as we look and think about that, Jesus, when he left to be with the Father, said that he would send the Holy Spirit, the Comforter, to be with us. To comfort us, that God himself, that light, would be there to work. It would shine into our everlasting, our lives, and we could trust on it. Jesus, in John chapter 1, in him was life, and the life was the light of men. And the light shineth in darkness, and the darkness comprehended it not. Jumping down to verse 9. That was the true light, which lighteth every man that cometh into the world. So we see that not only was it prophesied, not only has Jesus proclaimed it, but we see here that John, through the Holy Spirit, as he's writing about the coming of Jesus Christ into the world, that there is a light, that Jesus Christ is that light that was prophesied by Isaiah. How do we look at Jesus being the light of the world? Josh McDowell said it this way: for me, Christianity is not a leap, into the darkness, but a step into the light. That's a pretty good synopsis of it. Christianity is not a leap into the darkness, not going into the unknown, but it is actually a step into the light to be illuminated. When we accept the Lord Jesus Christ as our Savior, that Holy Spirit comes and lives within us. Then his word here in this Bible changes from a bunch of words written by people in a long time ago to being alive. And God, the Holy Spirit, will open it up to us through our salvation and through the Holy Spirit making it known to us when we think of that. So it is not a step into the darkness. It's not a leap into the darkness, but a step into the light. Strong's defines light in the New Testament as to make manifest. To make something manifest. You know, we shine a light on something. I remember my great-grandson, and Marty's got pictures if y'all want to see them. But my great-grandson, when he was just a little bitty boy, he had a little flashlight that he would, and he and I would get on our hands and knees and look under the cracks of the doors and make believe bugs was there, and we'd be hunting those bugs. He would use that flashlight to illuminate what was there. You know, that light illuminates several things in us. Because when we see ourselves as compared in the light of who Jesus Christ is, who God is, the holiness of this Lord and Savior that we have, we see ourselves in that. It shines a light on us and makes us realize that we are falling far short of what God would have us be. Thus, the Holy Spirit brings conviction. And then we're drawn to the light of Jesus Christ through the Father. And then Jesus Christ, by what he has done upon the cross, God shines a light on this, that we have a need for a Savior, that we have a need for a Savior, and that Jesus Christ is that way, the only way unto salvation. If we look at John 1, thinking about how that when we read those verses just a moment ago, and then look into 1 John chapter 1, verse 5, it says this: this then is the message which you have heard of him, and declare unto you, that God is light. In him is no darkness at all. John, here in the epistle, he says, we can take the truths of God's word in the first writings of the gospel that he had done through the Holy Spirit. And he says, we can take this and we realize that God is light. And in him is no darkness at all. You know, I think of darkness. You know, we think of darkness a lot of times as being that thing where evil happens, that place where evil happens. And under the cloak of darkness, people break into homes and people do all kinds of mischief. I used to say tell my daughter, I says, if you're not home by 11 o'clock, says, Nothing good happens after 12, so you need to be home by 11. Because under the cloak of darkness, things happen bad. But you know, I think about him that no darkness in him at all. No lying. He is impossible for God to lie, to tell an untruth. It is impossible for any evil to ever touch his life. Matter of fact, God the Father cannot look upon that sin. That's the reason why he sent his son Jesus Christ to die on the cross. That when we stand before him, we are washed as white as snow from the crimson stains that are within us by his precious blood. And that we stand clothed in the garment and the righteousness of Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Amen. That's right. God, in him there is no darkness at all. Hebrews chapter 1, verse 1 says this. God, who at sundry times and in diverse manners spake in times past unto the fathers by the prophets, hath indeed